Good morning, everyone. So for today's lecture, first we are going to take a quick recap whatever we had covered in the last lecture, and then we'll move ahead with the other topic. So in the last lecture, we had started with our chapter number 9, that is business model. So whenever we talk about business model, it is nothing but an hypothesis model that helps you to understand your business, that helps you to know what the customer wants, who will be your customers, and how as an enterprise, or you can say an organization, you can do best to meet the customer needs. Because whenever you are starting with a business, the foremost thing which is important is knowing your customers and identifying their requirements. So in this process of business modeling or a business model, you are going to understand your customers, their requirements, their needs, how you are going to take a one step forward and you are going to fulfill the requirements, you're going to make a profit from it, and you're going to grow your business. So whenever we talk about business model, the important or essential factors are the customers, understanding their requirements, you as a business partner or a businessman who is starting with a business model, how you can achieve your goals to meet those customer requirements, and at the end of the day, the thing which is very much important is how you're going to generate a profit. So these are some factors which are very much important whenever we talk about business model. Next, we have short history of business model. So whenever I talk about short history of business model here, it means that whenever we talk about business model, we always go to that traditional mechanism or traditional systems. So which it refers to that initially when the business has come into the picture in the olden days, and during those time also we used to have exchange of goods and services. That was a barter system. Like against one goods, you're going to get another goods or services, and then later on you used to sell that. So the business model still today has that traditional practice of buying and selling, or you can say exchanging the goods and services and making the business. So this is something which has come from traditional model, and this is something which is still there into your current model as well. Because whenever we talk about selling of products, we are not the one who are going to have the products in bulk as per the customer requirement. So we always need to buy from someone, we need to exchange, and then we need to sell it back again. So this is the traditional model which is working since years, and the working is still the same for the current business model as well. So the first is space and time. So when we talk about space and time, it refers to that with respect to space. Space refers to the scenarios, you can say, with respect to years, how the working of the business model has changed. Like initially people used to travel a lot. They used to move to different places to just sell their products. They used to carry quantities of goods with them with intention that they will have good number of customers for the day they can sell their products. Now with space and time, like in the current business models, if you see, they are mostly online based system. Now you don't need to travel anywhere. You just need to have an internet. You need to have a system which will help you to communicate with your customer. So now with space and time, you're refers to that initially people used to travel, they used to rent a place to sell their products, and with respect to time, like initially the olden models, people used to work hard more when they commit respect to the business model. Now the people just need to make some contacts, and now there are many social platforms also available. With this, the becomes easy for you to connect with your customer. So that is your space and time. Second is from craft to mass production. So whenever we talk about craft production, it refers to that you are producing in lesser quantity, and whenever you are producing it, you are not producing yourself. You are buying from someone and then you are selling it. Okay. So whenever we go for a craft production, the profit margin is always going to be less because you are going to buy from someone and you are going to keep some amount of profit with you, and then you are going to sell it back again. So in craft production, if you talk about, there is a less margin of profit. But if you move to mass production, where you are starting customization of the products yourself, whatever you want, whatever resources you want for making your businesses, if you are starting producing yourself and then you are coming up with a model, so in that case, the profit margin will be very high. So this is your from craft to mass production. So craft production refers to just producing in small quantities, and whatever you are producing, you are not producing yourself. Rather, you are taking from someone and then you are selling it to your customers. When I'm talking about mass production, you are starting with the customization. You are hiring skilled set of persons who are doing the production of that particular resources, and later on, you are going to sell that product to your customers. Next, we have long tail of internet. So when I talk about long tail of internet, it refers to that with respect to space and time, how the internet has played an important role. It has changed the entire working of the business model. Now the people just need to connect with each other over social media platforms, have an interaction. They can exchange their goods and services, tell the pricing, and accordingly, even they can give the cash on delivery services to the customers. So now with internet, it has become very easy to connect to your customers globally. Initially, this was really not possible. People used to travel across different places. There was a lot of goods to be carried and that used to be shipped with the boats and they used to do it all the way. So it becomes very difficult initially to start with the business model. But now with the emergence of internet, things have become very easy and everybody can easily communicate with each other over the platform and exchange their ideas. So what we have learned from the history? That there are some Asian models that refers to your make thing and then sell it. This is always the concept of business model, that is customizing something and then you are selling it, or you are making yourself something and you are selling it. Initially also the people, those who were there, they used to make silk cloths, they used to do pottery. So they used to make themselves and that they should travel different places to sell them. Second, new technologies have inspired new models. So with the internet emergence, there are new business models which are coming up. And all these business models are basically over the social media platforms and connecting globally with your customers. Third, however, there are recurring patterns and common models. There are countless variations. There are many business models which are working over the internet platform, but most of the models which are there, they are common in nature, but the working of their pattern at times differs from one another. Finally, we have new business model that has power to change the world, the way the branded soap, unrest in mass communism and the mass production change the notion of work itself. So now whenever there is a new business model, it is a new set of business where there is a lot of advertisement. With the advertisement, they have started promoting their business. They have started taking actors, actresses, and they have changed the entire way how the business model used to work. So without this, with this concept of business model, by promoting the brands, this has become a new way of business model, and this has actually changed the way of mass production. So this was something which we have learned from our history, that was with respect to the business models. Next, we had business model canvas. This is a very important model. So whenever you want to start with the business, at the very first place, they have to refer this as template. This template is called as a business model template, and this was designed by Alexander. So all the people, those who want to come up with their startup and they want to start, they can usually refer this business model. This will really help them to understand that what are the set of inputs which are required and what will be the corresponding outputs for the same. So in this model, you can see the very first is your key partners. So whenever I talk about key partners, it refers to nothing but the people who are going to be as your partners into your business. In case if you need some kind of investment into your businesses, then can refer this key partners, who can be the companies, who can be your friends or anybody who can help you with respect to the financial aid and help you to buy the resources. So that is your key partners. If you are self-financing your business, if you have a good amount of money and you want to put into your business, then the key partners will be something which will be absent here. That is why this is not filled here. It depends on the choices of the people whether they want key partners or not. Those who want money as a finance, those who want companies, those who want key partners who will help them to build their businesses, add some money, make some investment, they will have this section filled. Otherwise, this section will be vacant. That is why this is something which is optional in nature. Next, we have key activities. So whenever I talk about key activities, it refers to what are the important activities which you really need to do for making your customers attract. So the activities which you need to do is, first you have to make sure that you are marketing very good. As far as possible, whenever you are new in the business, marketing has to be really good. Make sure that whatever you are producing, it is producing at a lesser cost so that you can attract the customer. You should start providing free samples of your product and you should do a good amount of research and development, because you are not only the one in this market who is doing the business. There are already many people who are doing their business since years. So just have a good research and development. Try to look what they are doing, how they are attracting the customers, and how your working and their working is different from each other. Next comes your key resources. So key resources here refers to that what are the important resources which you require. You can say the raw materials which you need to create your product. At times you can also hire the people that will help you to do the same. So that is your key resources. So in this key resources, the activities which are important, you should have a refer your group brand names. You should have a good distribution network wherein you can buy the products at lesser cost. You should have a good research and development as well. You should make sure that whatever key resources you are buying from someone as a part of raw materials, you should have a good idea of it, that from wherever you are buying, they are the good retailers and they will give you at a good price. So you need to make a very good analysis of the market and you have to identify from where you can get your resources at better price. Next is value proposition. So when I talk about value proposition, that is nothing but refers to that how you're going to give a value added services to your customers or what platform you're going to choose for your product or for your services to be given to your customers. Mostly you can see that all of the franchises which are respect to your food industry, they always keep the offers on the weekends. Only the reason is that they know that people are going to be free on weekends. So this is a good value proposition which is given to the customers. And accordingly, on that particular weekend, they make more sales as compared to the sales in the other weekdays. So that is the value proposition. That is nothing but what value-added services you are going to give to your customers. Next we have is customer relationship. This is a very important thing which has to be a long-lasting relationship between the company. And you can now, the choices has become very vast. You can maintain a good customer relationship over physical mediums, over the online mediums or social platforms. So these are only the people who is going to always come back to you. They will help you to grow your business. So it is very much important that you should have a good customer relationship with your customer. Next is channels. Channels is nothing but the medium through which you can reach your customer segments. So you can advertise your products, you can distribute the free products, you can give delivery of the services, you can even provide after sales services. So channels actually depend upon what is your customer segment, where do they live, and according to the customer segment, the medium of channel will also keep on changing. Next we have customer segments. So when I talk about customer segment, that refers to the customers who will belong to different segments. Some can be your housewife, some can be students, working professionals. So that is all your customer segments. That refers to what are the different categories of people who are going to be the part of your business, who are going to be your customers. So initially, whenever you start any business, you have to first identify that who are going to be your intended customers. So accordingly, you will target only those customer segments and you are going to attract them most. Next is we have cost structure. So when I talk about cost structure, that nothing but how you're going to put a price on the resources or what price you're going to put into your resources. Okay, always you have to make sure that whenever you are defining your cost structure over your business models, you have to make sure that they are not very much expensive. Because as a customer, they are going to survey the market, they are going to take rates from different companies, or you can say vendors, and then they are going to take from one which is at the lesser cost. So it is always suggested that cost structure has to be very less as compared to the vendors which are already there into the market and they are selling the same product. So here in this cost structure, you have to make sure that you are going to produce at the lesser prices. The marketing has to be really good. You need to do the analysis of your business resources in the market, that whoever are your vendors, what they are selling and what price they are selling the same product, and the distribution market, or you can say the distribution medium for buying the products, has to be something which will be the lesser in cost. Because if this is the lesser in cost, the profit margin will be definitely high and you can give your products give your customers good products at a lesser price as compared to the different vendors in the market. Last is your revenue streams. So when I talk about revenue stream, here the main question which always comes into your mind is how am I going to make money? Because whatever money you're going to make into this process, that same money you're going to utilize it and you're going to put for the next process. So whatever is the output of your first business model, you're going to use that as the input for the other, where you will start buying the raw materials for the business. So this revenue stream refers to how you're going to make the money. So with this business model, if you start putting your requirements into it, you will understand that what are the inputs and what may be the corresponding outputs. Next we have is for whom is the business model. So to be very simple and precise, when we talk about business model, this is for all the people who want to have businesses or who have an intention to come up with their businesses. Okay, so basically whoever have an idea of an startups into your mind, they can refer this business model. So it is not specifically segregated that business model will refers to only this set of people. Business model is for everyone who has an intention to do a business, who has an idea into their minds, and they have to take it to the next level. So it is always suggested, if you are very much new to this business field or you don't know about business model, first refer the business model canvas, put your ideas into it, understand the working of your model, and then start with your model process. So at the initial, it is always suggested that don't go for alone as a business. Do the business in the partnership, especially with the people who are there into this field since years. Take them or go with them as a business model, or start the business with them, so that even in case if there is any problem or if you stuck somewhere, they will definitely help you to come out of this. Because if you are new and you are starting up with your startup, and somewhere or the other, since you don't know the business protocols, and if you fail at some point of time, in that case it will be a big loss of you. So it is always suggested that put your requirements into business model canvas, and always do business in partnership if you are new to this business modeling process. Next we have the topic, that is subscription. So whenever we talk about subscription, this is something which is there all the time. If you know the businesses which are very new, they always start with this subscription. So basically subscription is a new way, you can say, to attract the business to the customers and make them know about the business. Okay, so subscription is nothing but you are going to give customers, or you can say your intended people who are interested, you are going to give them products or services for the specified time or period. Okay, that you are going to give a free service like for 1 month, or maybe you are giving a trial period for the customers just to let them understand that how is your product, whether they are liking it or not. Okay, and later on, once the trial period ends off, you are going to tell them that this is the per month charge for it. Okay, so this is a new way of attracting the customers, because everybody who is not going to try the products if you are not giving a product for free to use. Okay, it is just like a sample only, you can say, a free distribution of the sample. So whenever you are distributing a sample which is online in nature, okay, like your softwares or anything which is of type software based or online, there you cannot physically go and tell them that you use it. So something which is done over the online mediums, over internet, that is a subscription, which is the most common method of business, which will help to attract the customers, and we are going to give some free services so that they can use our products or they can use our software for some period of time, just for a trial period. And after that, you can tell them just 1 day before that your subscription is ending. So now this is the per amount you have to pay. Mostly there are some companies still, those who give free trial period for a longer time. Okay, they will not give you a value added services, or they will not give you more options or functionalities, but the basic which is possible for them, they can give it. Okay, so that is your subscription. So just simply, subscription refers to that you are giving some services to your customers on different you can say time periods, and once the subscription ends, the customer, if they like the product, then they will purchase your subscription. Mostly when we talk about subscription, the people, those who opt for subscription option, is for music, for magazines, for the books. So all the hobbies which are there, which people hold, or you can say customers hold, they usually go for subscription, and later on they can go for buying of this particular subscription. So this is, you can say, a new business model which is based on the idea of selling a product or services, they where they can receive monthly or yearly subscription revenue. Even for the newspapers also, you can go for subscriptions. If you like something, then you can go for it after the subscription period ends. Next we have customization. So whenever we talk about customization, this is something which is very, very much important, as I've already told you before. So whenever I talk about customization, in other words, you can say it is something referred as personalization. Okay, that is providing a service or a product to customers as per their requirements, as per their needs. So that is called as customization. So customization is very, very much important. This is something which will really help you to stay in the market for a longer time. The reason is that everybody wants customization, everybody wants the products as per their requirements, as per their taste and liking. So if you are giving a model or if you are giving a products as per the customization, that will play a very important role. I'll just portray one example of customization. Dell was the company who had come up with the laptop initially. Okay, so initially it isn't used to provide with much customization, but after few years it has started with customization, wherein you can just select what color you want, what configurations you want. Still now it is providing customization, and with that customization attribute, its products or its sales has increased very faster. Okay, so customization is very much important because you are letting the people to select. Now the Dell has done what, you know, first it used to ask like, what is your price range? And according to price range, it used to give you that these are the list of the customization which is possible. So you can select with that and you can come up with yours. So the customization in business is very much important because you are giving the customer choices. You are giving the customers the freedom that whatever you want, you decide yourself. This is at the end, you're going to quote that this is the price of your customization. If you want to of the lesser price, then this is something can be eliminated, which can be replaced by this or something like that. You can tell your customers. So customization is something which has been played a very important role in the market, and this has actually attracted a good amount of customer segment. So whenever you're going to go for customization, you can also at times go for mass customization, which is a very common technique of marketing and manufacturing. So when we talk about customization, you are giving a power of flexibility or personalization to make custom-made products to your customers. And with this power, customers will definitely attract to you and they will help you to make your business grow. Next, we have be a key resource. So whenever we talk about be a key resource, you are refers to that you should be one of the most important person who is going to generate the resource. So that refers to your be a key resource. So it is nothing but that refers to that whenever it comes to selling of products or whenever it comes to buying of the products, the very first thing which we should come into your mind, we should be you. Okay, that is a key resource. Like if you are selling a product at a very lesser price as compared to the market, so where the customer, the very first point of contact will be you, and you will be a key resource who is going to provide them with the resources. So when we talk about Internet of Things business model, it is not very much important option be a key resource because there are many vendors in the market and there is mass production as well. But whenever we talk about be a key resource in other aspects, other areas of the business, and there it is very much possible. So here it refers to that you are positioning yourself as a key resource or a partner in somebody else's business model because you are the important person who is going to generate the resources and which will help you to make the business. In IoT, there are small companies like your Adafruit companies there which will actually help you to sell the electronic components, and visually they sell those people, those components who are very much keen to make a IoT startup. So accordingly, they have identified the customer segments which belongs to different age groups or segments, and they sell the product. So key resource here refers to what? You are the key business person in the market who is generating the resources at a lesser price, and anyone who knows you, if they want to buy any resource, you are the first point of contact to buy the resources. So with this, you can also give the customization to your customers. You can give them at a lesser price and you can grow your business. So that is your be a key resource. Next, we have sensor networks. So whenever we talk about sensor networks, in the diagram, you can understand that it is nothing but a group of networks, which are nothing but your small power devices, which will be of type either wired or wireless, depending on what you want. And this together is going to comprise your network infrastructure. So basically, this sensor networks does what? They record the conditions in different environments. That can be your environments like your industrial environments. It can be hospital or any number of environments which is there. Okay. So basically, this sensor networks connects to the internet, or you can say computer networks, and it transfers the data for analysis and usage. So basically, this sensor networks sends the environment, and accordingly, it will control the environment and give you back the results. So it is just an interaction between the computers and the environment, and with that, they are going to exchange the information. In IoT, sensor network has been a very important topic because there are many data sources which are actually doing it. There are many sensors who are sensing the data from the environment, like we have already seen before, temperature sensors, light sensors, pressure sensors. So these are all the sensors which are sensing the information from the network and giving the result back. So in IoT, the sensors plays a very, very much important role, and they will help you to sense the environment information. So there can be also many third-party apps who can generate the sensors and they can capture the information without your consent. So whenever we are thinking about sensor network, it is something which is very important, because the companies who are there, they actually use the sensor networks to capture the customer preferences, understand the customer behaviors, and accordingly they can grow their business. Next we have take percentage. So when we talk about take percentage, it simply means that whenever you are making a business model or whenever your business is successful, you are going to take a share from it. So it depends upon how many people are there into the business, and accordingly that percentage will be equally divided. Or if there are not much people, you are only the one, then the entire part goes to you. So basically the take a percentage refers to that what amount of share you are going to take into your business and how much profit you have made altogether into your business model. So mostly in businesses, the share actually divides among the different people who are the part of the business. And in every business, most of them, they are different part of the people. There are different, you can say, business partners, you can say the vendors who are giving you the resources. So there are many people, and accordingly you have to divide the share among them, and you have to take your percentage, whatever is your amount. So that is your taking a percentage. Next we have funding an IoT startup. So funding an IoT and startup, when we have, is something which is there. So here from this segment we are going to start with how does the funding takes place and what are the different types of funding. Okay. So whenever we talk about word funding, it actually is the fuel that powers your business, you can say. Okay. So business, those who want to grow faster, they want to make more profit, they need to go for some amount of funding. So depending on what type of business is there, the funding mechanism also keeps on changing. Okay. So the funding mechanism, you can say somewhere or the other, is depending on the type of business which you intend to do. Okay. If you see the current situation of the business, there are already different owners who are already there into the market. They have put some amount of money into it and they are waiting for money to reap back again. Okay. So there are many funders there into the market. I don't know how many of you know about it, but there are different small auctions also which takes place, where the people have to come up with their startup ideas and there are funders who are there, and if any funders like your idea, then they are going to invest money into it. Okay, so this is something which is also there. So if your startup idea is really good, if they like it, then they are definitely going to do the funding. Mostly in IIT, this all type of functions takes place when there are many funders who are coming. Everybody have to just give up their startup ideas and they will come up with their funding. So this is something which is already there into the market. Okay. So funding is very much important because this is an initial step where your idea will start taking the baseline and you can create more ideas of it. You can add more, you can say, more ideas into it, and you can enhance it and you can come up with a new working model. So what startups is something which has been very much important. In IoT, there are many startups which are there, but only the thing is that in IoT, the funding becomes more difficult because here you're dealing with a software and hardware. So in this case, the funding cost goes very high. Okay, like if you talk about a startup of IoT, okay, one of the most common startup of IoT is your home automation system, which was initially not there. It was a startup and soon it has taken its way, and now you can see that it has been implemented at many of the places. That's a different story, that it is not 100% successful, and we know the reason why it is not successful, but this was a startup. It was an idea of somebody, and today it has been as a part of an application which is being known as in IoT. So startup is something which is any idea of a person which can take its next level, and this will be something which will be helpful to the society. So any startup which is there, it should contribute to the society. It should something which will be beneficial to the society. Then only the people will be interested in funding. Because if you put that particular startup into the market, people are definitely going to attract, because it is minimizing the complexity and it is helping them to do their task easily. So when we talk about startup funding, there are something called as crowdfunding, which we are going to see in the next topic ahead. There is something called as savings, loans, equity. So this is all comes as your startup funding. Okay. So if you don't have a, you can say a funder, or you don't have someone who is going to fund into your startup, then in that case, you have to start with your investments only. You have to start with your savings only. Whatever savings you have, you can take it from your family. You can take it from your friends, and you can start up with your startup idea. Okay. Because if your startup idea grows well, then you can, in just few months, you can pay back whatever you have funding you have taken from your close ones. Okay. So this is your funding and IOD. So if you don't get a funder from outside, then you have to start funding from your internal sources only. That will help you to come up with your startup idea. Next we have is venture capital. Okay, so whenever we talk about venture capital, mostly all the startup companies who want to grow, who need a certain amount of investment, they usually go with this venture capital. So venture capital, in simple words, we can say it is a money which is invested in the business that is very small maybe, okay, but it depends like who are the investors who has invested in your money. But if your startup idea is really good, then there is a lot of potentiality that it will grow in a lesser time. Mostly venture capital investment is also called as risk capital. The reason why it is called as risk capital, because you really don't know that whether the money will give you back double of its amount or at least the amount which you have invested. Because there is a risk of losing the money if your venture, that is nothing but your idea, which doesn't succeed, and it will take a lot of amount of period of time for your investments to fructify. So this is something which is a problem. So venture capital is nothing but someone has invested some money into your business, and it will tell you that after this period of time, I want my money back, and that has to be double of your amount. Okay. So money lenders, those who are there in the market and those who help you to grow your business, they give some amount of money. So they tell you that within this period of a time, they want their money back, and with that percentage of interest. So venture capital is something which is a suitable option wherever you can refer some capital sources or companies. There are now many companies who are coming up with this venture capital, and they are very much interested in funding into your businesses or into your startups. But only the thing is that they will give you some amount of years, and with that amount of years, whatever money they have invested, you have to give them back. So features you can say of venture capital is there is a very much high risk into it. Okay. There is a lack of liquidity. There is no liquidity there. Okay. And most of the venture capitals or investments which are made are done for the innovative projects. The projects which are going to definitely grow in the market, which is definitely going to give your investments payback. Mostly innovative projects are go for the venture capitals. Next, we have government funding. So whenever I talk about government funding, the word itself is self-explanatory, which says that if government is doing some amount of funding into your projects, into your startup ideas, that is called as government funding. Okay. So mostly this is kind of a funding which will be come as a part of your financial aid, which will be given by the local government for the projects which they think are beneficial for the society, which will help to the society, and which will actually will be useful to the people. So that then only the government will go for the funding. Mostly this type of funding is very, very much difficult, and it is very, very much rare, because this is something, it is not like will be given to every other person. Only the people, those who are actually, you can say, doing a project or startup which is very much beneficial for the society, then only they can go it. Okay. So mostly when we talk about governments, they are usually investing in the small sectors to promote the industries, to promote their technological enhancement. So they are more doing it with the small scale industry rather than going for the large scale industry. So the government first funding, in that they have their own venture capital funds. They have the money which they have already generated so far. They are going to keep it aside, and they are going to use that same money for generating the projects or helping some people who have making a startup idea. So in this, when we talk about government funding, two things are very, very much important. That is the outputs and what are your spending constraints. So output here refers to that whatever is your startup idea, how it is going to help the society, how it is going to help the people, what goals it is going to fulfill, that you have to be very much sure that what is your output, what is the outcome of your startup idea. Spending constraints here refers to that what amount of money is expected from the government to spend into your projects. Okay, and whatever money is being spended by the government, you have to tell the every proportion that where it is going to be utilized, how it is going to be utilized, and where you are going to put that money. So each and every record of the constraints which are there into your project and the money which you are received from the government, how you are going to utilize it, that has to be explained. Okay, so mostly we don't get this government type of funding, which is very rare, I'm telling you before also. But this is something, if there is someone who doesn't have their own, you can say, funders in the market, they don't have their own savings also. So in that case, they can get some help, they can grant government, or they can ask for some permission along with the ideas, along with their projects, and they can ask for the funding from the government. Next we have is the crowdsourcing and crowdfunding. Okay, so this crowdsourcing and crowdfunding we will take for the next lecture, because this is a very, very much important topic, and we will take it in the next lecture. Okay, so that's it for the day. Thank you, everyone.